Good afternoon, good morning, depending on where you're at. It might be a very good morning to Brother Morgan and some others who are in Hawaii and other places, and it's early in the morning there. I'd like to encourage you, if you don't have the slides available to you right now, to if you have access to the internet, to go to the internet and get them from smyrna.org. There's a direct link to download or to view the slides there on our home page, and they're available. It's called the Incarnation in the Old Testament. And that's what we're talking about. And I'd just like to go to slide number two. And for those who don't see the slides, I'm not going to describe this slide yet. But for those who can see it, tell me what you see. Can someone tell me what they see? A lamb or a cat? Well, actually, it's not a lamb and it's not a cat. It's a shadow. What we have here is a picture of a shadow of a cat. Now, the shadow is not the real deal, is it? Shadow is not the real cat. It just looks like the cat. It's outlined like the cat. Now, the Old Testament is a book of symbols and types and even what the Bible calls shadows. And we're going to see this word used about three times this morning here as we begin. And the first place I want to look at it in is in Colossians chapter 2. So if you'd open your Bibles with me to Colossians chapter 2. And we're going to read verses 16 and 17. Let no man, therefore, judge you in meat, or in drink, or in respect of a holy day, or the new moon, or the Sabbath days, which are a shadow of things to come, but the body is of Christ. Now, Paul's speaking here about not judging people concerning certain aspects of their religion. And he says there were things that were shadows, but the body is of Christ. And they were shadows of things to come. We see that the word shadow here is from a Greek word, skia, and it means a shadow, and the word body is the word soma, the Greek word soma. And I want to just share with you here a quotation from the book Judging the Sabbath from Ron du Perez. And he says in his book on page 86, since the skia is here generally understood to mean not a literal shadow, but a foreshadowing, it follows that things to come means things that lay in the future when the observances were first ordained. Thus, the things to come have already come with Christ. The Greek term soma, literally body, this is the Greek word for body in the New Testament, comes into play here contextually, meaning the things itself, the thing itself, the reality. As Ernest Scott indicated, in Christ we have the reality of which the sacred observances were the prefigurement. And that's from the book Judging the Sabbath, page 86 from Andrews University Press. Now, just turn with me in a few places and show you how this word soma is also used in Matthew chapter 26 and verse 26. And as they were eating, Jesus took bread and blessed it and brake it and gave it to his disciples and said, take, eat, this is my soma. This is my body. This is my body. This term soma means the reality or the substance. In John chapter 2 and verse 21, here Jesus had said, destroy this temple in 3 days, I'll raise it. And they thought he was speaking about the temple there in Jerusalem. But it says he spake of the temple of his body, of his soma. And so in Colossians, he says there are shadows, but the body is of Christ. The reality is in Christ. Now, Paul speaks about shadows in other places too. If we would turn to Hebrews chapter 8 and verse 5, speaking about the priesthood in the tabernacle service in the temple, it says concerning these priests in verse 5, who serve unto the example and shadow of heavenly things, as Moses was admonished of God when he was about to make the tabernacle, for see, saith he, that thou makest all things according to the pattern showed to thee in the mount. And he says, so they served as shadows. Now, we saw a picture of a shadow earlier of a cat. Will the shadow meow? Will the shadow ever touch you, ever hurt you? I mean, the shadow might go over where you're at, might go over your shadow, but you can't feel a shadow. You might feel the effects of something that creates the shadow. You might feel a blockage of wind, a blockage of light, of that which makes the shadow, but the shadow itself has no effect upon you or anything else. Because it's no reality. it may help us to understand what the cat looks like. If I had never seen the cat, I'd understand what the cat looks like. I might understand how fast the cat can move as I watch the shadow, but I don't have the cat. But once I have the cat, I have the substance, I have the reality. And Paul is saying that there were several types in the Old Testament, and they were teaching types. They helped us to understand the plan of salvation. They gave us wonderful instruction, but they weren't the reality. And we need to understand they were not the reality. The reality is found in Christ and in Christ alone. In Hebrews chapter 10 and verse 1, he says, "For the law having a shadow of good things to come." And here when he says the law, he's not speaking about specifically the Ten Commandment law. He's speaking about the Torah, the Old Testament really in general. And these things that we learn there, they were a shadow of good things to come. There was something good that was going to come, which was the substance of the reality. And Paul said in Colossians 2 that that was Christ, that he is the reality. Now, the book of the Bible, this Bible, in the Old Testament, it's full of the gospel. From cover to cover, the Bible is about the gospel. The Old Testament is not simply a dispensation of law, and the New Testament is a dispensation of grace. The whole Bible is a book of the gospel. And in the Old Testament, though, it's the gospel in types and symbols, and the New Testament is the gospel in reality. And so, if the Old Testament does teach us about the gospel, and the incarnation is one of the most important vital cogs in that machinery we call the gospel, then surely there's something about the incarnation that is prefigured or discussed in the Old Testament. That's what our topic today is. The study of the incarnation in the Old Testament. It is the study of the humiliation of Christ revealed in prophecy, in symbols, in types, and shadows. From times eternal, the Bible says that there was a compact of peace that had been devised between the Father and the Son should sin enter into this universe. In Zechariah chapter 6, we read about this in verses 12 and 13. "And speak unto him, saying, Thus speaketh the Lord of hosts, saying, Behold the man whose name is the branch, and he shall grow up out of his place, and he shall build the temple of the Lord. Even he shall build the temple of the Lord, and he shall bear the glory, and shall sit and rule upon his throne, and he shall be a priest upon his throne, and the council of peace shall be between them both." And the Hebrew is the word for two, between the two. We know both means two. Between the Father and the Son, there was this council. And when sin's curse was felt upon the earth, this compact became active. And Jesus Christ began to explain to the angels, the loyal heavenly angels, about what was going to happen next. We have a statement from the book Early Writings, page 150. It says that he that is Jesus would leave all his glory in heaven, appear upon earth as a man, humble himself as a man, become acquainted by his own experience with the various temptations with which man would be beset, that he might know how to succor those who should be tempted. And this experience would also include the fact that, as we go to the next slide, that he would take man's fallen nature, and his strength would not even be equal with theirs, referring to the angels. As he was talking to the angels, he said, "I'm going to take the nature of fallen man, and my strength won't even be equal to your strength." And that's from Early Writings, page 150. Now, the first gospel promise we find in the Bible is in Genesis chapter 3 and verse 15. So let's turn. There God is speaking to the serpent, speaking really to Satan, through the medium of the serpent. And he says, "And I will put enmity between thee and the woman." Now let me just pause for a minute. What does the word enmity mean? Hatred. That's right. There should be a hatred between humanity and Satan. If there's one thing that we can have an aversion to, it is Satan and all evil. And it says, "And between thy seed and her seed, and it shall bruise thy head, and thou shalt bruise his heel." There's going to be a seed of the woman. There's also a seed of the serpent. And that seed has become incarnated into something called the man of sin. But there's a seed of the woman that would be an offspring of Eve that would come, that would finally destroy Satan and all those followers of Satan. And this, of course, was a promise about Jesus Christ, that Jesus Christ would come to this earth as a human being and live under the laws of humanity and obey God's law perfectly and become the perfect sacrifice for our sins. And this seed, though, would not come as Eve had stood in her innocence in Eden, but after 4,000 years of sin. The contrast in human inheritance is seen in the fifth chapter of Genesis. If we turn to Genesis chapter 5 and verse 1, it says, "This is the book of the generations of Adam. In the day that God created man, in the likeness of God made he him." Genesis 1:26 says that God said, "Let us make man in our own image." And in Luke chapter 3, as you go through the genealogies there, it says that Adam was finally the son of God. He was the son of God. And he was made in the image of God. But now notice if we go down to verse 3. "And Adam lived 130 years and beget a son in his own likeness." Did he beget a son in the likeness of God? No, and he could not now, because he had lost that likeness through his fall and sin. The only humanity that could be formed in Eve was fallen, sinful humanity, degraded, a degraded nature that was hers as a result of sin. And so if we would go to our next slide, from Patriarchs and Prophets, page 80, it says, "While Adam was created sinless in the likeness of God, Seth, like Cain, inherited the fallen nature of his parents." And every single one of us, friends, every child that's been born in humanity, every son and daughter that's ever been born since then, has been born with a fallen, degenerate nature. The first gospel promise indicated that the seed of the woman would come, meeting the law of equivalence that we discussed last week, meeting sin on its own battleground, as it were, accepting the responsibilities that we have, meeting sin just as we meet it and where we meet it. In our next slide, we have a statement from the Review and Herald of February 24, 1874. It says, "What love, what amazing condescension. The King of Glory proposed to humble himself to fallen humanity. He would place his feet in Adam's steps. He would take man's fallen nature and engage to cope with the strong foe who triumphed over Adam. He would overcome Satan, and in thus doing, he would open the way for the redemption of those who would believe on him from the disgrace of Adam's failure and fall." And now we want to begin to look at some of these types that are in the Old Testament that this prophecy tells us about. And the first one is found in Genesis chapter 28. Genesis chapter 28. And here we have the story of Jacob. And Jacob has deceived his brother, and now he's fleeing. Genesis 28. And he goes to sleep. He uses a rock for a pillow, and that's not probably very comfortable. I've never found it to work very adequately for me. But it says in verse 12 that he dreamed a dream. "And he dreamed, and behold, a ladder set up on the earth, and the top of it reached to heaven, and beholding the angels of God ascending and descending on it." Now, this ladder was symbolic of something. Angels don't need a literal ladder. You know, I mentioned to Michael the other day that the eaves need cleaning and to get a ladder, because he just can't reach that high. And I can't reach that high. If I'm going to go up on the roof, I have to have a ladder. Angels don't need a literal ladder to go between heaven and earth. But there's something that has to bridge the chasm between righteousness and sin, between heaven and earth, between holiness and wickedness. And that ladder is Jesus Christ. Jesus Christ claimed to be this ladder. In John chapter 1 and verse 51, Jesus said, "Verily, verily, I say unto you, hereafter you shall see heaven open, and the angels of God ascending and descending upon the Son of Man." Jesus claimed to be that ladder that the angels of God would ascend and descend upon. And he says he is the Son of Man. And if we continue reading here in Genesis 28, going down to verse 14, it says, "And thy seed shall be as the dust of the earth, and thou shalt spread abroad to the west, and to the east, and to the north, and to the south. And in thee and in thy seed shall all the families of the earth be blessed. And behold, I am with thee, and will keep thee in all places whither thou goest, and will bring thee again into this land. For I will not leave thee until I have done that which I have spoken to thee of." And Jacob awaked out of his sleep, and he said, "Surely the Lord is in this place, and I knew it not." And he was afraid and said, "How dreadful is this place! This is none other but the house of God, and this is the gate of heaven." And notice he said, "This is the gate of heaven." Christ is that ladder, becoming a part of humanity, meeting the law of equivalence. Christ became the gate of heaven, the house of God. His life, as the ladder that Jacob saw, would bridge heaven and earth. The communication broken by sin would again be restored to man. For in and through Christ, God would again commune with fallen mankind. In John chapter 14 and verse 6, Jesus said, "I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man cometh unto the Father but by me." And so it's only through Christ we have communication with heaven. Only through Christ can we find our way to God. And he is represented as a ladder. And any attempt to move or to change this ladder then is an attempt to move Christ. And that is a false gospel. And the Apostle Paul warned the believers in Galatia about this in Galatians chapter 1. Galatians chapter 1, verses 6 through 9, Paul writes these words. He says, "I marvel that ye are so soon removed from him that called you into the grace of Christ unto another gospel, which is not another, but there be some that trouble you and would pervert the gospel of Christ. But though we, or an angel from heaven, preach any other gospel unto you than that which we have preached unto you, let him be accursed. And we said before, so say now again, if any man preach any other gospel unto you than that ye have heard, received, let him be accursed." And so that's a pretty strong indictment against anything that tries to change that ladder. Can you imagine? You're working on a two-story house. You're at the top of the ladder. And someone comes along and tries to kick the ladder out. How would you feel about that? That'd be pretty dangerous, wouldn't it? Kevin, you've been up on a lot of ladders, I know, right? And you want someone steadying the ladder, holding it. You don't want someone shaking it or moving it or tipping it over. Friends, we need a solid foundation, and Christ is a solid foundation. But when people come along and try to take that out, they undermine the whole gospel. The man of sin, this seed of the serpent, claims to open and shut the gate for whomsoever she pleases. Instead of connecting people to Christ, they remove Christ far away and they offer a Tammuz that they may weep for instead. Now, just after the flood, a group of people gathered on a plain in the land of Shinar, and they began to build a tower that they believed would soar into the heavens. Isn't that right? You can read about that in Genesis chapter 11. And what was that tower called? Does anybody remember? It was called the Tower of Babel. In our next slide, we have a quotation here from Freeman and Chadwick's book, Manners and Customs of the Bible, page 20. The word Babel, translation of an Anakin word that the scripture writers linked by a play on words with the Hebrew verb that means to confuse. The Babylonians, however, understood it to mean something more acceptable to them, the gate of God. See, we had this idea that Babel means confusion, and it does. But in their mind, it meant the gate of God. They thought that they were preparing a way to heaven. And so we have two concepts. We have the Tower of Babel. And one of those concepts about the Tower of Babel and all that's Babylon is found in Daniel chapter 2 and verse 11. Daniel chapter 2 and verse 11. Remember, Nebuchadnezzar had a dream and he wanted to have that dream interpreted. And the magicians and the, the sorcerers of Chaldea, they couldn't interpret that dream. And they couldn't tell him the dream either. But notice what it says in verse 11, what they say. It is a rare thing that the king requireth, and there's none other that can shew it before the king, except the gods, whose dwelling is not in flesh. What we're talking about here is two concepts. One that comes from Babel, this tower that was built with a base upon earth to reach to heaven, where the gods that don't dwell in flesh live. And the other is a mystic ladder that reaches from earth all the way to heaven, but it starts on heaven's end and comes down where the Word was made flesh and dwelt among us. And we have in our next slides just a little chart here. On the left, you see the Tower of Babel. God does not dwell in the flesh. Daniel 2:11. On the other side, Jacob's ladder. The Word was made flesh. John 1:14. And the Tower of Babel, man must build a base upon earth to reach heaven. And Jacob's ladder, God reaches down to man. Babel results in confusion. Jacob's ladder results in salvation, because Christ is the way. The message of the Old Testament was that God would dwell with man. He would become the seed of Jacob, and he would set up the gate of heaven upon the earth. That's what it said in Genesis 28:12, on the earth. The clear message to Jacob in that night of loneliness is progressively revealed in the continued revelation of God in the Old Testament. Let's look at the times of Moses some now. Can we turn with this in our Bible to Deuteronomy chapter 5 first? Deuteronomy chapter 5. This is part of the Ten Commandments being repeated. And I want to read this for a reason, and we'll notice why after we read it. Deuteronomy 5:15. He says, "And remember that thou was a servant in the land of Egypt, and that the Lord thy God brought thee out thence through a mighty hand and by a stretched out arm. Therefore the Lord thy God commanded thee to keep the Sabbath day." Now, as we read the Sabbath commandment in Exodus chapter 20, he seems to give a different reason there. He gives a reason there because of creation. And now he speaks about being delivered. But many Bible students have understood for a long time that the children of Israel, when they were delivered from Egyptian bondage, that was a parallel or a type, a shadow, as it were, of the Christian being delivered from the bondage of sin. And because redemption is a recreation process, you see, it fits right in with Exodus chapter 20. The Sabbath commandment that teaches our spiritual rest as well as physical rest also is a sign of our freedom from the chains of sin. And when the time came for God to bring deliverance from Egypt, he appeared to Moses in a burning bush in the region of Horeb on the backside of the desert. And in Exodus chapter 3, we read about this wonderful event. Now Moses kept the flock of Jethro, his father-in-law, the priest of Midian, and he led the flock to the backside of the desert and came to the mountain of God, even to Horeb. And the angel of the Lord appeared unto him in a flame of fire out of the midst of a bush. And he looked, and behold, the bush burned with fire, and the bush was not consumed. And Moses said, "I will now turn aside and see this great sight, why the bush is not burned." Let me just pause. Can you imagine any of us? If we come and we saw a tree, a bush, and it's on fire, but it's not being consumed, that would seem quite strange, wouldn't it? And when the Lord saw that he turned aside to see, God called unto him out of the midst of the bush and said, "Moses, Moses." And he said, "Here am I." And he said, "Draw not nigh thither, put off thy shoes from off thy feet, for the place whereon thou standest is holy ground." Moses was attracted by this unusual sight of a desert shrub burning with fire, and yet it was not consumed. And as he turned aside, he saw this phenomenon, and this burning bush, though, was a fit symbol or a shadow of Christ incarnated. The shrub well represented humanity, yet filled with the divine glory of the presence of God, it was not consumed. And you know, the Bible says that in Hebrews 12 that our God is a consuming fire. And yet here you have this shrub, this bush, lowly bush, and it's burning with fire, but it's not consumed. And in Jesus, divinity and humanity each held their place. They were blended together, neither to be assimilated by the other. In Selected Messages, Book 1, page 408, in our next slide, it says, "In Christ, divinity and humanity were combined. Divinity was not degraded to humanity. Divinity held its place, but humanity, by being united to divinity, withstood the fierce test of temptation in the wilderness. In the book Upward Look, page 260, was the human nature of the Son of Mary changed into the divine nature of the Son of God? No. The two natures were mysteriously blended in one person. Now, I'm going to tell you, theologians have haggled and tried to dissect that for a long time. In some statements, it's better just to accept them as they read. Now, I'm going to cover one more section today. This is going to become a two-part message because we're not even anywhere near halfway through, and we've had a lot of little problems, and it's kept us here longer. But I do want to cover one more point before we leave, because I know in the Sabbath school, the discussion was on the sanctuary some, and I want to continue an idea about the sanctuary and how this fits in. In Exodus chapter 25 and verse 8, God said, "Let them make me a sanctuary." Why? "That I might dwell among them." He wanted to dwell among them. Now, in that sanctuary, the one thing I want to point out is that this sanctuary was covered. It had several coverings on it. And I want you to notice what the outer coverings were in Exodus chapter 26 and verse 14. And while you're turning there, I want to remind you that God doesn't do anything by chance. God has a purpose and a detail for every aspect of everything that he does. In Exodus chapter 26 and verse 14, it says, "And thou shalt make a covering for the tent of ram's skin dyed red, and a covering above of badger's skin." There's a couple other ways that word could be translated, the word that's translated badgers. In our next slide, in the NASB, it says that it's a covering of porpoise skins. The Authorized Standard Version says seal skins. Probably some kind of marine creature that had a waterproof kind of leather. But probably not a very attractive leather. Not a very attractive covering. And so outwardly, this tabernacle where he was going to dwell had a pretty plain Jane look. Now inside, there was shimmering gold. Beautiful embroidered tapestry with gold fibers, gold threads in it, representing the divinity. But on the outside, this which represented humanity. And interestingly, whether it's a badger, a porpoise, a seal, those are all unclean animals, what are considered unclean animals. In Isaiah chapter 53, the prophecy about Jesus, the Messiah, his suffering. It begins in verse 1, "Who hath believed our report, and to whom is the arm of the Lord revealed?" But now notice number 2, verse 2. "He shall grow up before him as a tender plant, and as a root out of dry ground. He hath no form nor comeliness, and when we shall see him, there is no beauty that we should desire him." In other words, there would be nothing in the outward appearance of Christ that would draw attention. That would have an attractiveness to it. People weren't to be attracted to Christ because he was a beautiful, handsome, dashing individual. It was what was inside that was to draw people. And going back to Exodus now, in Exodus chapter 26 and verse 29, for example, "And thou shalt overlay the boards with gold, and make their rings of gold for places where the bars, and thou shalt overlay the bars with gold." These bars and the wood boards, the upright boards, they were all made of wood, but they had a gold plating on them. They had the appearance of solid gold. And so inside, there would be just a shimmering, beautiful place representative of divinity. But on the outside, no form or comeliness. The interior of the tabernacle, indeed, was glorious. And there was, I believe, 6 pieces of furniture and all of it together. But within inside the tabernacle, there was just 3 pieces, right? There was the ark. The 3 pieces in the holy place and one piece in the most holy place. You had the ark in the most holy place. And then in the holy place, you had the candlestick, which was made from a talent of gold, pure gold. You had the table of showbread, and then you had the altar of incense. And it was beautiful inside. It would have absolutely been dazzling to have looked upon. And there was the Shekinah glory. And all this was to reveal God's purpose for the human soul. That's right. I want you to go with me to the next slide. And here we have the beginning of a quotation from the book Education, page 36. Through Christ was to be fulfilled the purpose of which the tabernacle was established. That glorious building, its walls of glistening gold reflecting in rainbow hues, the curtains inwrought with cherubim, the fragrance of ever-burning incense pervading all, the priests robed in spotless white, and in the deep mystery of the inner place, above the mercy seat, between the figures of the bowed worshiping angels, the glory the highest. Notice this sentence. In all, God desired his people to read his purpose for the human soul. It was the same purpose long afterwards set forth by the Apostle Paul, speaking by the Holy Spirit, "Know ye not that ye are the temple of God, and that the Spirit of God dwelleth in you? If any man defile the temple of God, him shall God destroy, for the temple of God is holy, which temple ye are," quoting from 1 Corinthians chapter 3, verses 16 and 17. And this quotation is from the book Education, page 36. And in this quotation, she says that this is God's desire for his people to read his purpose for the human soul. That's for my soul and for your soul too, friends. But going back to this concept of Ellen White's, what she's speaking about here, and comparing this with John chapter 1, verse 14, Jesus Christ, as the pattern man, was to exemplify divinity and humanity combined. And John, he said that the Word was made flesh and dwelt among us. That word dwelt is skeno in the Greek. And as it says here, it's from number 4,633 in Strong's, and it means to have one's tent or dwelling. Young's literal translation in our next slides, it says, "And the Word became flesh and did tabernacle among us." He tabernacled among us. And this is what he wants to do. He wants to tabernacle among us today. And in this prefigurement of the Incarnation, in this shadow of the Incarnation, and this is just one, we have several more we'll continue looking at next week. We see here where Christ is showing us that he's willing to come down to understand and experience humanity as we have to live it and have to understand it. If I tell my algebra students I have 20 calculus problems for you to solve, they're probably going to look at me and say, "No way." I can try to tell my algebra students, "You know, you've got to do this calculus." And they're going to say, "But we can't." And I'm going to say, "But look how easy it is. And I can work all these problems." But it's not easy for them. It would be like the hawk or the eagle telling the bear, "It's easy to fly. I just glide through the air so easily. Why don't you fly too?" Of course, the bear says, "I'm not equipped to fly. I don't have the equipment to fly. I can't fly." And many people have the idea that Jesus has come to this earth and he said, "Look, you can live as I did. You can fly. You can do calculus." And we say, "You know, I don't have wings. And I've never taken calculus. I don't know Newton from Leibniz." But Jesus Christ, he's came down to our level, friends, to where he could live as we had the privilege and the ability to live. And he showed that if divinity and humanity are combined, and we become a partaker of the divine nature, that we can indeed overcome every sin in our lives. That we can become the Christian people, the Christian men and women that God wants us to be. You know, if you've tried Christianity and say, "You know, it just didn't work for me," or "I'm too weak," that's right. You are too weak, and it won't work for you. Nothing works for us in humanity as we are. And that's why we have to have God in our lives. The Word was made flesh and dwelt among us. And he wants to dwell among us today if we will simply open our heart to let him come in. But there's much more in the Old Testament that prefigures the Incarnation. There's many more shadows and symbols, and we want to look at some of those now. The most intimate yet fearful confrontation of the children of Israel with God occurred at Sinai. In our next slide, from Patriarchs and Prophets, on page 302, it says, "Here Israel was to receive the most wonderful revelation ever made by God to man. Here the Lord had gathered his people that he might impress upon them the sacredness of his requirements by declaring with his own voice his holy law." Now, what was the reaction of the people to this when it happened? Well, let's notice, let's read it in Exodus chapter 20. "And they said unto Moses, Speak thou with us, and we will hear, but let not God speak with us, lest we die. And Moses said unto the people, Fear not, for God has come to prove you, and that his fear
and that his fear may be before your faces, and that she sin not. But the Bible says that this mountain was on fire, there was lightning and thundering and smoking, and the people were just terrified and said, look, we don't want to hear this voice anymore. Moses, you speak to us, and you inform us of what we are to know and to do. Referring to this incident, Moses in his rehearsal before the children of Israel dealing with him in the wilderness prophetically described the nature of the coming voice that they would hear. Deuteronomy chapter 18, beginning in verse 15. The Lord thy God will raise up unto thee a prophet from the midst of thee, of thy brethren, like unto me. Unto him ye shall hearken. Let me just stop for a minute. The word hearken means to what?
Yes.
To hear or to listen, but in the biblical sense, when you hear the word hearken in the Bible, it really means more than just to listen. It means to come under what you're listening to obey. I'm sure, Terry, when you were growing up, you and Mac, your dad would say, you listen to me. And it meant to do more than just hear, didn't it?
Yeah.
That's right. I bet for sure it did.
Action was required.
Action was required. I am sure of that. It was for me too. Verse 16. According to all that thou hast desired of the Lord thy God in Horeb, in the day of the assembly, saying, let me not hear again the voice of the Lord my God, neither let me see this great fire any more, that I die not. And the Lord said unto me, they have well spoken that which they have spoken. I will raise them up a prophet from among their brethren, like unto thee, and will put my words in his mouth, and he shall speak unto them all that I shall command them. And so he says, I'm going to send a prophet like unto Moses, and I want them to hearken or to hear him. And in verse 19, he says very explicitly here that if they come to this place and they don't hearken, then I have a right to judge them. Look at what he says. He says, and it shall come to pass that whosoever will not hearken unto my words, which he shall speak in my name, I will require it of him. I will hold him accountable. And so when Jesus Christ, the way, the truth, and life comes, when this greatest revelation of heaven and earth comes to us in the character of God and shows us what God is like and demonstrates in human flesh, then, he says, if you don't hear that, maybe you didn't catch this of what I said before, but if you don't hear that, I'm going to require it of you. And today, beloved, when we read the words of Jesus Christ, we need to take heed. I remember a story, a man was saying that he had shared a parable with an individual, and the individual said, well, it really doesn't mean that, it means something over here. And the man said, wait a minute, he says, are you contradicting Jesus Christ? He says, Jesus Christ said this. And he says, I don't care what you think it says. And you can contradict me all you want. But don't contradict Jesus Christ. Because, beloved, you're going to be held accountable.
Amen.
You're going to be held accountable. In Numbers chapter 21, your turn, we find here a very interesting and unique shadow of the incarnation. And that was in the fiery serpents which threatened Israel. In Numbers chapter 21, beginning in verse 4, and they journeyed from Mount Hor by the way of the Red Sea to compass the land of Edom, and the soul of the people was much discouraged because of the way. Now let me just pause there. What do you mean because of the way? What would make them discouraged about this way? You know, they just couldn't quite get enough salt in their diet, and they couldn't sweeten up the dessert quite enough. And the bed wasn't quite soft enough. Or they had to get up too early to get the manna.
No four-lane highways.
No four-lane highways. In other words, the way just wasn't so palatable to what they wanted. And they became discouraged. And verse 5, and the people spake against God and against Moses, wherefore have you brought us up out of Egypt to die in the wilderness? For there is no bread, there is neither any water, and our soul loveth this light bread. What was this light bread?
Manna.
And in other words, friends, they weren't satisfied with what was set before them. And they murmured and complained. And the Lord did something about it. What did he do? Verse 6. And the Lord sent fiery serpents among them, and they bit the people, and much people of Israel died. I think we need to understand that that land was a land full of serpents already. And these deadly creatures had been all around them before, and they didn't even realize it. But God had been withholding those serpents back. He had been protecting them by divine power from those serpents. So he said, okay, you don't like what I'm doing for you? Let me just step back and you see what happens. And so in his setting the fire service, he was simply stepping back and letting them have their reign of terror upon those people. And when in repentance they recognized their sin, notice in verse 7, wherefore the people came to Moses and said, we have sinned, for we have spoken against the Lord and against thee. Pray unto the Lord that he take away the serpents from us. And Moses prayed for the people. And the Lord said unto Moses, now here's how your prayer is going to be answered, Moses. Make thee a fiery serpent, and set it upon a pole. And it shall come to pass that every one that is bitten, when he looketh upon it, shall live. And Moses made a serpent of brass and put it upon a pole, and it came to pass that if a serpent had bitten any man, when he beheld the serpent of brass, what happened? He lived. The Bible says that he would just look and believe, he would live. Of course, he had to believe to do it, right? If you didn't really believe looking was going to help, you weren't going to do it. And you know, Jesus says, look unto me and be ye saved, all the ends of the earth, for I am God. The Bible says that we look to Jesus, the author and the finisher of our faith. That we believe in him. There wasn't anything in that brass serpent itself that had any healing virtue. But it was the Israelites extending their faith to God, believing what he said would happen. As they would look, their faith would connect them to heaven and they would receive healing. And so today, friends, when we are sick with sin, when we are filled with sin, we look to Jesus today by faith, and he is just as able to heal us from the malady of sin today as he was from the poisonous venom of those serpents years ago. This shadow, more than any other, revealed the depths to which Christ would go to meet the requirements of the law on the level of mankind. In 2 Corinthians chapter 5 and verse 21, the Bible says, 2 Corinthians chapter 5 and verse 21. For he hath made him to be sin for us who knew no sin, that we might be made the righteousness of God in him. The Bible says that he was actually made to be sin for us. This was not simply to meet the demands of the law, but Jesus would clothe his divine person with the fallen human nature of man, that he might meet in that nature the forces which tempt man to sin. In the book Desire of Ages, on page 175, it says, as the image made in the likeness of the destroying serpents was lifted up for their healing, so one made in the likeness of sinful flesh was to be their redeemer. In the 1888 Materials, on page 1451, she says, what a strange symbol of Christ was the likeness of the serpents which stung them. This symbol was lifted on a pole, and they were to look to it and be healed. So Jesus was made in the likeness of sinful flesh. He came as the sin bearer. Moving a little bit down the history of time and through the Old Testament, we come to the book of Ruth. And remember a few weeks ago we were talking at the end of the service and we're having a visiting with people online. Brother Reuben and I hope you're listening today, Brother Reuben. Brother Reuben was on and brought the issue about Ruth. And I want to talk about Ruth today for just a minute. Some of us remember the story of Ruth, and she had lost her husband, he died, and she went back with Naomi, her mother-in-law, and there was a piece of their estate that could be redeemed, but it could only be redeemed by one nearest of kin. And in Leviticus chapter 25, we can read this regulation, we should probably, verse 24, in verse 25 it says, and in all the land of your possession you shall grant a redemption for the land. If a brother be waxen poor and has sold away some of his possession, and if any of his kin come to redeem it, then shall he redeem that which his brother sold. In other words, if I became in debt or I was just in a place where I was really hard up and I had to sell my property, you have to realize that property today is dealt with differently than property was dealt with in Israel. If you sold that land, you actually had a chance to buy that land back. You could redeem it back. It didn't just really, in a sense, permanently become another person's land. In fact, land only stayed in someone else's possession for a maximum of 50 years until the Jubilee came, and the time of Jubilee would revert back to the family who had owned it. And so, but if I sold my land because I had to pay a bill, maybe I had a big hospital bill, I had to pay my land. And pay for my land. But maybe my brother comes in, he's my next of kin, and he says, you know, I want to buy that land back from you. And he's got it, he has the privilege and the ability to buy that back for me. He can restore it to me if he chooses. In verse 48 and 49 also, it says, after that he is sold, he may redeem again. One of his brother may redeem it. Either his uncle or his uncle's son may redeem it. Or any that is nigh of kin unto him of his family may redeem it. Or if he be able, he may redeem it himself. And so the nearest of kin would have the first opportunity to buy or to redeem this land. Now, there was someone by the name of Boaz. Remember Boaz? He wasn't the nearest of kin, was he? But he was a near kin. And so he gave the person who was nearest of kin the opportunity to redeem this property and all that went with it, which would include marrying Ruth. This man didn't want to do that. And Boaz said, I will. And Boaz is the nearest of kin in that case, redeemed the land, redeemed the inheritance, and bought the inheritance of Elimelech, which had been lost during the sojourn in the land of Moab. Boaz, a near kinsman, arranged to redeem that which had been lost, and by his marriage with Ruth, reestablished the title to the inheritance. And man, through sin, had lost not only his inheritance, but was himself in bondage, and he could not break. In the Desire of Ages, page 327, it says, the work of redeeming us and our inheritance, lost through sin, fell upon him who is near of kin unto us. It was to redeem us that he became our kinsman. Closer than father, mother, brother, friend, or lover is the Lord our Savior. And I think it's interesting that in the genealogy of Christ, the Bible is very explicit on this, that he has at least two kinspeople in his genealogy that were not of the children of Israel. Ruth was one. She was a Moabite, remember? Do you remember who the other one was? She came from a little city called Jericho. Yeah, her name was Rahab. You remember what her profession was? She was a prostitute. She was a harlot. You see, friends, Jesus Christ, he keeps bad company. And he comes down and he says, you know what? I'm not ashamed to call you brother. I have a prostitute in my family tree. I have a former idolatrous worshiping, you know, Moabites in my family tree. It's okay. I'll take you. You can become part of my family. The book of Isaiah, known as the Gospel Prophet, carries a very interesting prefiguring of Christ. And of course, he also, since he is the Gospel Prophet, must somehow discuss the Incarnation. And we notice this in Isaiah chapter 7, verses 14 and 15. In verse 14 it says, therefore the Lord himself shall give you a sign. Behold, a virgin shall conceive and bear a son, and shall call his name what? Emmanuel. And now notice the next verse. It's not disconnected. Butter and honey shall he eat, that he may know how to refuse the evil and choose the good. This verse is also important to us today. But he says that the Lord is going to give a sign. And Matthew chapter 1, verse 23 says, behold, a virgin shall be with child, and shall bring forth a son, and they shall call his name Emmanuel, which being interpreted is God with us. Now, Matthew perhaps interprets this to a great degree based upon what the reality of the situation was. And I say that because of this. The Hebrew word that is translated virgin in Isaiah 7:14 in our next slide is Alma. And it means a young maid of marrying age. According to Strong's, it's a damsel maid, can be a virgin. But it's used, I believe, 9 times in the Old Testament. 4 times it's translated virgin, and you see there the other 4 times outside of Isaiah. It's also translated damsels, maid, and even Alma. And here we see a usage chart of it, how it's sort of split up in our next slide. And there you can see those references again. But there's another word. It's used by Isaiah, and it's translated as virgin, and it's a word that probably more properly means virgin in that literal sense, and that's the word Beth Ulaw. And this word is used five times in Isaiah. In fact, we give the references there. Isaiah 23:4 and Isaiah 23:12, Isaiah 37:12, 47:1, and 62:5. This word is translated from the Hebrew 38 times as virgin, 7 times as maids, 5 times as maidens. So it's a word that clearly has a stronger connotation, a stronger connection to meaning a woman who has never had a relationship with a man. So why is this important? Why do I bring this up? I think I have here a chart also for Beth Ulaw. You can see predominantly it's translated as virgin or virgins. Of course, Jesus was born of a virgin birth. That is not denying. That's not what I'm trying to in any way insinuate that he wasn't. The emphasis that Isaiah is placing, though, in Isaiah 7:14, is not necessarily that he is simply a that he has a virgin birth, but he has a birth of a woman. He has the birth of a woman. In other words, he comes from a woman. And this would be emphasized by Paul in Galatians chapter 4 and verse 4. He says, God sent forth his son made of a woman. Matthew, in his quotes, interprets it in the light of events. The woman was a virgin. But this does not seek to lessen Isaiah's emphasis. For Matthew's explaining the meaning simply, again, is that it is God with us. This God-man who has come in humanity, he is born of a woman. Is born into humanity. And God, through Isaiah 7:15 that we read also, teaches us that Jesus would meet the same problems of life that we face. And he would need to choose between good and evil. He would have to make choices, just like we do. He would have to choose the good and refuse evil. Jesus would be God with us at our level, setting an example in a way that we could understand and that we could follow. Jesus Christ would not be insulated from the forces that seek to bring the perversion of man. But he would be a free moral agent to choose and to decide for himself in the human environment. In the youth instructor of July 20th, 1899, it says he was a free agent placed on probation, as was Adam and is every man. As was Adam and is every man. Man. Unto us a child is born, Isaiah 9:6. Unto us a child is born. Unto us a son is what? Borrowed? Lent? Hired out? Given. Unto us a son is given. And his name shall be called Wonderful, Counselor, the Mighty God, the Everlasting Father, the Prince of Peace. You know, name represents many times in the Bible what?
Character.
He is given us and comes into humanity as a child. He is, as it says in Isaiah 11:1, to grow out as a root of Jesse. The incarnation would give to Christ an ancestral inheritance in humanity like all of the sons of men received. And in Desire of Ages on page 48, it says, like every child of Adam, he accepted the results of the working of the great law of heredity. What these results were is shown in the history of his earthly ancestors. He came with such a heredity to share our sorrows and temptations and to give us an example of a sinless life. Now, what is the purpose of an example? Why do people give examples?
To be copied.
To be copied. That's right. And so he's given us an example of a sinless life because, brothers and sisters, he wants us to have a sinful life. In Isaiah chapter 53 and verse 2, it says, for he shall grow up before him as a tender plant and as a root out of dry ground. He hath no form nor comeliness, and we shall see him. There is no beauty that we should desire him. Isaiah introduces the sufferings of the Messiah by first noting a point of the incarnation. You know, this chapter that deals with the death of Jesus Christ, his death and his sufferings, it begins with a point about the incarnation. Just as a tender plant grows from one stage to another until it reaches maturity, so Jesus Christ would develop from childhood to manhood in harmony with the laws of human growth. Yet there would be no outward attractiveness. In commenting on these verses, The servant of the Lord had said in the youth instructor of December the 20th, 1900, "Think of Christ's humiliation. He took upon himself fallen, suffering human nature, degraded and defiled by sin. He took our sorrows, bearing our grief and shame. He endured all the temptations wherewith man is beset. He united humanity with divinity. A divine spirit dwelt in a temple of flesh." Youth instructor, December 20, 1900. And I encourage you to read the whole article. I encourage you to check out the context, because the context is that that divine spirit is not speaking of the Spirit of the Father, it's speaking of His Spirit. It's speaking of Him. In prophecy, in symbolism, and in type and shadow, it was foretold that the one who was to come would accept man's fallen nature, meeting the demands of the law and accepting the challenges to disprove all of Satan's accusations. Jesus would be, and He is, the seed of the woman, Genesis 3:15. He is the one near of kin that we read about in Leviticus and in Ruth. He is one likened to His brethren, Deuteronomy 18. He is one who became sin itself, 2 Corinthians 5:21. He is the ladder, as John 10, verse 7 says, He is the door. And John 14, 6 says, He is the way. Jesus would be lifted up so that those who see Him in His true character might be lived, might live. He would set up on the earth a ladder which would reach clear to heaven. Though incarnate, and through His incarnate self, a door of access would be opened for the fallen sons of man to the throne of the Eternal. And Satan, the serpent, would finally be crushed and destroyed forever. We are told that when we want a deep problem to study, let our minds be fixed upon the Incarnation. It is a deep problem. And not a problem in the sense of being something solvable. We never understand it all, but we can study it and understand it. And we are told that it will pay rich dividends for those who will study it. But friends, this is a vital part of the plan of salvation. And without this part of the plan of salvation, everything else fails. It's like having an intricate machine like a V8 engine. You have connecting rods, and you have pistons, and you have valves. And if the crankshaft breaks, the rest of it doesn't work. The camshaft breaks, the rest of it doesn't work. You have to have all those parts working together for it to function right. And in the plan of salvation, if the Incarnation fails, the plan of salvation fails. If Jesus sins upon earth, the plan of salvation fails. If He doesn't die for our sins, the plan of salvation fails. If He's not resurrected, the plan of salvation fails. And you know what else? If He doesn't minister as our high priest in heaven, the plan of salvation fails. And He cannot. He cannot minister as our high priest unless He truly is that mediator who can reach both man and God. The Bible says there is one mediator between God and man, the man Christ Jesus, 1 Timothy 2:5. And it is not the Pope, it is not some preacher, prelate, or priest that can be your intercessor. You have to go to Jesus direct. Amen. You know, sometimes people come to ministry and say, "Lead me to Jesus, help me to come to Jesus." That's fine. Ministers can do that, they have that responsibility. But we're not Jesus, you see. We can lead someone, we can direct them to Jesus. But they have to come to Jesus themselves. You have to come to Jesus Christ yourself today. But He is that way. And He was prefigured in the Old Testament through those types and shadows. And the reality we have with us today. What a blessing, friends, as Christians. What a privilege we have. That He is our elder brother. I think that in the Sabbath school there was a lesson on the family tree, and it was talking about our elder brother. And Christ is that elder brother who's not ashamed of us, who's not ashamed of us. How precious that is to me. I can tell you things, and I'm not going to, but there are things in my life that could be revealed, and I can just look back and say, you know, only by the grace of God I'm alive today. Only by the grace of God I stand here today. My record is not pretty impure of itself. My record is ugly and defiled and terrible. But through Jesus Christ, though your sins be as scarlet, you should be as white as snow. Though they be red like crimson, they should be as wool. And friends, He says, if you be willing and obedient,
Their story is about being obedient. If you be willing to be, you should be good of the Lamb. The only way we can become obedient is to become children of God through faith in Jesus Christ. By grace that you saved through faith. Not of yourselves, it is the gift of God, not of works, lest any man should boast. May our boast be, Paul says, by boasting anything, it's in the cross of our Lord Jesus Christ. As we look to Jesus for his life and his death and his intercession for us, we find eternal life. This is life eternal, that they might know thee, the only true God in Jesus Christ, and thou Son. He that has the Son hath life, he that has not the Son hath not life. 1 John 5:13. It's just that plain, friends. If we have Jesus, we have life. A lot of people today claim to have Jesus. A lot of people claim to be, you know, Christians. But Jesus says, not everyone. It says unto me, Lord, Lord, shall enter the kingdom of heaven, but he that doeth the will of my Father. So today, friends, if we want to be a Christian, we have to commit our lives and surrender our whole life to serve him. And if we will do that, he will help us and we will be the people he wants us to be. May God have his mercy upon us, and may our hearts be set to do his will today, to walk in his ways, to realize that he has made available a path whereby we may walk, and it's a plain path.